Broadcasting live from high atop the Sycamore Room in the Norman P. Murray Community Center, it's Breakfast with Gary and Kelly, featuring special guest, sax man Eric Darius.
Yay!
Thank you very much. Welcome to Breakfast with Gary and Kelly, ladies and gentlemen, season three, featuring America's Sweetheart and Kelly. So,
excuse me? I think you said that wrong.
Whatever.
And I do have a new do.
Doesn't she look spectacular? And really, is there anybody that fishes for a compliment better than Kelly? Really?
Okay, so he's got a new jacket.
Nice. I know, it's got to go back, so don't spill it. So, ladies and gentlemen, let me tell you about my day yesterday.
Oh, my.
It was an interesting day. It was a challenging day. We had somebody lined up to come and do the show, and we were very excited about it, as I know all of you were very excited about it. And then the darn flu hit.
Yes.
You know, this is what happened. So I'm freaking out. And then it was brought to my attention that an amazingly talented young sax player had moved out here from Florida like 6 months ago. I didn't even know he was here.
Yes. He was a secret.
This is a guy, had I known he was here, I would have been on the phone, come do the show anyway. And when I found out he was, I called him, and he has stepped up huge. Mm-hmm. This is a guy, listen to this.
Yes, he has.
He has shared the stage with Prince, with Santana, with George Benson, all kinds of great folks. And we're proud to tell you that he is here on our stage for you today. Please welcome Eric Darius.
Yes.
Thank you. Stick around and have breakfast with Darius.
Nice.
Yes. Not too shabby. I know, those are real.
Wow.
Oh my God, am I ever glad to see you.
It's great to see you too.
Oh man.
We're so happy.
So much. This is unbelievable that you have come here today. I mean, I'm glad to have you. We wanted to have you anyway.
Last minute deal.
I'm glad this all worked out.
I can't think of a better way to start off 2013.
Exactly.
You know?
And that song, what was that song that you played right
it's
there?
It's called Setting It Off. It's off my latest album, On a Mission.
Wow. Wow. Amazing.
Thank you.
And I've never seen a silver saxophone before.
I brought it just for you.
Seriously, and the bling.
I did.
And the bling, is that all? Because this is like, this is, you got it going on. This is like, look at him, you guys. Whose shoes are those? That's you or me.
I don't remember.
Oh, okay. Well, you got to know these things.
I do.
It's like, oh, those are shoes, yeah. Anyway, so, talk to us.
How was your holiday?
It was great. Thank you. Happy New Year to you, too. Yeah, to all of you, also. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
My holiday was great. It was very low key. I had an extremely busy 2012, just on the road 24/7. So it was nice just to kind of recharge the batteries, lay low a little bit, and it was very nice. Nice to relax for a change.
Good, good.
Yeah.
Tell me about moving out here.
When did you do that? You
know, why did I not get the memo?
Well, I didn't make a big announcement that I was moving out here, but I've been thinking about it for a long period of time. I've been in Tampa, Florida since I was 3 years old, so that's home.
Tampa, Florida.
That's right.
We have one.
And he came out here for you.
He did. But yeah, I've been thinking about moving out here for a long period of time. I'm always out here in Southern California for shows, for recording, for meetings, so I'm like, why not be here?
Exactly.
There's just so many more opportunities.
Well,
I just moved out here about 6 months ago.
We're glad that you made that decision.
Glad to be here. Thank you.
So where did you end up moving to? Los Angeles?
I'm in the North Hollywood Studio City area.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Good
That's
job.
Right in the middle of it, man.
Right in the mix.
You're right there.
Yeah. Nice. So what has that done for you now since you've been out here? Besides, killed your budget for gas, housing.
Well, other than gas, which is absolutely crazy.
Yeah, it is.
Just the accessibility, just being here. I mean, there's just so many more opportunities out here outside of just performing, from songwriting to collaborations to so many other things. So it's just been great just having the opportunity just to be here. When I get a call, I'm there. So it's awesome.
As I well know. As I well know.
And we are so glad that you took that phone call.
My pleasure. I'm glad I did.
You know, I remember the first time that I saw you play in Catalina.
Uh-huh.
And what was that? Was that 2004?
The first time I played it was 2004. Yeah, it was.
There's no reason that I got that right, by the way. But how old were you?
I was 21.
Yeah.
Oh, 21.
Because I remember everybody reacted as they reacted here today.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, it is, you have fun up there, don't you?
I do. I mean, there's nothing more that I enjoy than being on stage, performing in front of an audience. So this is what I was born to do.
Wow,
it really is.
Absolutely.
And you knew that at a very early point in your life,
didn't you? I did. I started playing saxophone when I was 10 years old. I come from a musically gifted family. My dad plays the bass. My mom sings and plays the piano. My older brother plays the drums. My sister sings.
So you're born into this.
I was born
into music. You were always listening to this music.
But it wasn't until I was 11 years old. I was performing in Switzerland at the Montreux Jazz Festival.
What were you all doing at 11, huh?
Wait a minute.
I know what I was doing when I was 11.
It wasn't. You were performing in Switzerland?
I was. I was with this group called America's Youngest Jazz Band. The band was from ages 5 through 12. There was about 30 kids in the group.
And how did you get on
all over
that?
The world.
I was really good at Power Rangers when I was 11, just so you know. I was really good.
I was playing Barbie dolls, but I mean,
I was still playing with Power Rangers, don't get me wrong.
How did you get on that?
Well, my dad had found out about the group, America's Youngest Jazz Band. They're based out of Tampa, Florida.
Okay.
And Sonny LaRosa, he's about 80 years old. He's been working with this group for about 25, 30 years, and he brings kids into this group, ages 5 through 12.
Okay.
And they play Dixieland, swing, Count Basie, Duke Ellington music, and my dad thought it would be a great opportunity for me.
Okay.
So I joined the band when I was 10.
So is that an audition deal?
Yeah, you have to audition.
Yeah.
So your dad, obviously, having your mom and dad in a musical way, when you said, hey, I want to play the saxophone, they went, great. They didn't say, oh, we wanted you to be a doctor.
Oh, no, no. They were so supportive, very supportive.
Yeah. So did you take lessons or
I did. I took lessons for about 6 months.
Okay.
I was working.
You didn't have to. What I was getting at was, did you have an ear
really?
For it?
I did. I mean,
and then also my other question is,
I'm really starting to hate you, Eric. Just so you know.
And why did you pick the saxophone?
I don't think I really chose the saxophone. I kind of felt like the saxophone chose me.
Ooh.
I was just at church. I was 9 years old, and I saw the saxophonist play at my church. I just fell in love with the sound of the saxophone.
Okay.
I mean, I grew up listening to a lot of David Sanborn, Grover Washington Jr. when I was 4 or 5 years old, so I always loved the saxophone. But actually having the opportunity to hear and see it and experience it was just a mind-blowing experience.
Okay.
And that's when I knew that it was my calling.
Wow.
You know, it's really interesting. And church music was so important for you and Jakeem too, who has been here.
Yep.
I missed that. I really do. I feel like I got gypped out of good music at church. Let me tell you.
It doesn't
matter, but it was like a couple of nuns on a guitar and it was like, wow. Well, that's hot, sister. That's really. You know what I'm saying? I mean, sorry. You know, but should we give out the phone number right now? Because it'll be, you know, the calls will be coming in. But it's really true.
Yeah.
I mean, that is.
Oh yeah.
That's a different thing, isn't it?
Yeah, I wouldn't be here had it not been for that. I mean, that's where it all started.
Okay, so 11 years old, you're in Switzerland.
Yeah, I was.
Okay, then what happened after that?
I
mean, seriously, something had to happen.
Well, once I turned 12, I was officially too old for the band because the band's from ages 5 through 12. No, literally,
again,
once
I'm
the
really
kids turn 12,
you.
Then they bring a new kid.
Okay, so what did you go to the senior group?
So. Well, I actually started my own band once I turned about 13.
Okay.
And I was in. In Tampa, Florida, I just started performing in the local scene, doing restaurants, bars, clubs, parties, weddings at 13.
Okay.
And
I was still playing with
Barbie
dolls.
So it's a problem for you to meet girls too, huh?
Not at 13.
Right.
We'll talk about that when he turns 15.
Yeah, there you go.
Exactly.
There you go.
Exactly.
So you were playing in clubs at 13? Okay.
Yeah, doing
so
all the bars and clubs.
When did
and
we start recording and actually?
Well, once I got to high school, I went to Performing Arts High School in Florida, in Tampa. Blake High School of Performing Arts. I studied music there.
Okay.
I was in the wind ensemble, jazz band, marching band, jazz combo, basketball team, soccer team, track team. So I did a little bit of everything.
You were busy.
I was very, very busy.
No time for girls.
No, I made time. It's all about time management. All about time management.
By the way, welcome to the club where Kelly shakes her finger in your face.
But I actually started recording literally that first year of high school.
Really?
I made my first demo CD. I was 14. And so that really gave me the opportunity to get a lot more shows locally. And then I started doing shows in Orlando, then Miami. Then it just kind of started spreading throughout high school. And that's really where I got my start.
Wow.
How about your first recording deal?
My first recording deal was with Higher Octave Music. And they came and saw me perform the Clearwater Jazz Festival in Florida. And I think I was 19 when they saw me perform. And they just fell in love with my stage show. And they're like, we want to sign you. So I was extremely thrilled.
Yeah.
And I'd literally just gotten out of high school about a year and a half at that point.
Isn't that something?
And it was just such a huge blessing.
It's like you're on fast forward.
Yeah, my life has always been on fast forward.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I mean, I'm here today when I got the call yesterday.
Yeah.
So press the button.
Wow.
That is so true. That is so true. You talk about your stage show because it is just high energy. I mean, have you been like that since the time you started doing this?
Yeah, I've never really been shy. I mean, I love performing in front of audiences. That's really what gives me that thrill. I mean, that's the highlight for me. It's great to be in the studio, but there's nothing like performing in front of a live audience. I feed off of the crowd's energy. And growing up, I was always watching tapes of James of James Brown and
Michael
Jackson.
Yeah, you're old.
Yeah, well.
What kind of tapes?
Tapes of James Brown and Michael Jackson and Prince, and I just always loved the energy that they brought to the stage and how they electrified the audience. Yeah. So that's kind of what I've always tried to do every single time I step on stage.
It's fun. It's fun stuff. Well, it works. It works, doesn't it?
It does.
I think they dig it. Talk about writing. Mm-hmm. You. When did you start doing that?
Well, my first composition was at three. No, I'm joking.
Wow.
I actually didn't realize I was writing music before I was even playing the saxophone. I mean, I was always just coming up with little song ideas, little melodies. I would kind of...
At what age?
I was maybe 4 or 5,
I
but...
I knew it! Did you have one of those little tiny pianos?
No, I didn't.
Did you have a baby grand in
we
your...
We did.
Oh,
we
had a... So I could see him at the
I was just kind of messing around.
Oh, that's good stuff.
But I always had songs and ideas and melodies flowing in my head even before I started playing the saxophone. But I didn't really start seriously writing music until I was about 13.
Okay.
That's when I really started to.
Okay.
That's
now,
when I
do
really
you have brothers and sisters?
I do. One older brother, younger sister.
Okay, so, and I'm going to like digress a little bit. But I do know, because I read this book, and it talks about when you're in the womb and you're around music a lot, you come out more musically inclined and a little bit more smarter than the average bear. No, I'm serious. It was called Secret Life of the Unborn Child, and I actually read it because I put headphones on my belly when I was pregnant with my son. And he's not a genius, but he's got I didn't do it for my daughter. So, sorry, honey. But she turned out okay. But she's not.
Of course she'll now be in therapy after this.
Yeah. I hope she doesn't watch this episode.
No, she's in Minnesota.
Well, it's been great, everybody.
So I suspect that your mom, when she was carrying you, had all this music going on.
Yeah,
now,
I think so.
Now, my theory, how's your brother and sister? What are they? Are they musically inclined?
They are. My sister is incredibly talented.
Really?
And a great singer. Some of you might have heard her sing before.
Yeah.
But she's actually going to be working on her own project pretty soon.
Really?
So I'm excited about that.
How old is she?
She's 26.
I was going to say she's 12.
Yeah. I had to think about it for a second.
Exactly. And your brother, what's he doing?
Well, he was in the military. He went to the Marines out of high school. And so he didn't really get back into music once he got back.
Well, that's okay.
But he started a family, but he's still very much so into music.
Okay, so see, my theory is right.
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank
your folks have got to be thrilled.
Oh, yeah.
They are. Yeah, I mean, the great thing is I've been blessed with parents that are so supportive. I mean, every single step of the way, they've been there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, I didn't have parents that told me to stick to the books. And I mean, they did.
Yeah.
Cause
well, they probably did both.
They did both, absolutely.
Because they wanted you to have that musical influence.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's good. Yeah, we need that more.
Yeah, we do.
Yeah, we do.
Eric Darius is our guest this morning, thankfully, and we're going to take a break and come back, and he is going to play for us. So please stick around here on Breakfast with Gary. Welcome back to Breakfast with Gary and Kelly, everybody. Eric Darius is here. We're so glad he's here. I'm telling you.
And all your bling.
Exactly, exactly. You should have seen the bodyguards when he went to get that thing out. Very nice. What are you going to do for us, man?
I'm going to play a few songs for you, if that's okay.
Yeah, yes, heck
definitely.
Yeah.
Want
heck
to.
Yeah. All right, well,
we
just let it rip. Eric Darius, everybody.
Do your thing.
Thank you.
Just getting warmed up. I think we'll do one more. And this song I'd like to do for right now is actually a song that went to number one on the Billboard charts. Thanks to all of you, because I couldn't have made it without you.
This is a great
and a special shout out to KSBR for playing my music and supporting me from day one. So thank you. And this is the title track of my Going All Out album, and it's called Going All Out.
Thank you.
goodness. That's Eric Darius. Why don't you take another break? Come back in 10 little bit more. Stick around here. Breakfast Gary and Kelly. Welcome back to Breakfast with Gary and Kelly, where we're all being shamed into realizing how little talent we have. It's an awful, awful way to start off the new year, being humbled like this. I hope it's not as painful for you as it is for me, ladies and gentlemen.
Wow.
Eric, I think they like you. Yeah. I think they like you. My goodness.
Well, I love them.
No wonder. Well, I love them. See,
absolutely.
No wonder you've liked this. My God, how fun! You know what? There is. I don't know if this is gonna work, but we'll try it. Uh-oh. There is an 11-year-old sax player sitting out in the audience right here. Today.
Is that him right there?
Yeah. Little Stefan, stand up.
Stefan,
stand up.
What? There he is. See that? And he came here. He came here to see and to hear you. What would you want to ask him? What would you want to find out? You don't
Anything?
Know?
Anything?
Nothing.
You got a question?
You want to do this though, huh?
Think about it and we'll come back to you. How's that?
Okay. What do you think? You want to get up here and do this like this though? Would that be fun? Yeah, not too bad. Not too bad. Oh man. Talk about a couple of the things that really jump out from you know what you've done in the short time that you've been out there. I mean, you literally shared the stage with Prince?
Yeah, I have. Oh, wow. That was an incredible experience. It was about 6 years ago, and I've been great friends with a lot of the guys in his band.
Yeah.
So this was when he was in Vegas at 3121. He had a club in Rio. Do you guys remember that? And he was there for, I don't know how many months, but he was there for a period of time, and he was performing at his club, 3121. Hmm. So I was just going to be in Vegas hanging out with some friends. I had the weekend off. A rare weekend off. And I just wanted to go hang out and check out the show. I'm a huge Prince fan, love his music. And so I called up my friends, said, hey, I'm gonna be in Vegas, love to check out the show. They're like, if you're gonna be in town, you might as well come and play with us. I was like,
God.
What? Wait a minute, wait. Were your friends with Prince?
Yes, they're in the band.
They're in the band. I missed that part.
They're in the band.
Well, so. Now, wait a minute. Was this really a surprise?
Well, I mean, I wasn't expecting that. I was just going to be a spectator, and I just wanted to enjoy the show.
Well,
I became a part of the show.
Oh,
yeah.
Wow.
How much did you play?
I played a few songs, which was incredible. I was just blown
did
away just
turn
sharing
around
stage
and,
with him.
Look at you or point
in a very
at you.
Sly way. He was like, You.
That's got to be intimidating.
It was cool. It was a little intimidating. I don't normally get intimidated, but I have to say at that point I kind of was.
Yeah, he would do it.
Yeah,
he
absolutely.
He would do it. What is the event, man? And it's up on the internet too. It's like the greatest guitar solo ever.
Oh,
it's him and isn't it? I think it's While My Guitar Gently Weeps. He does that. You know the one I'm talking about?
No, I don't.
It's just crazy and it's like an all-star thing. You know, and it's, I think, Clapton and everybody is in this band. And
I've
Jeff
heard
Lynn,
about it, yes.
Yeah,
yes,
and Jeff
yes,
Lynn
yes.
and all these people. And then Prince walks out and he just, like, blows it up. You know, and everybody, you know, they're all going, okay, that was nice. Get out.
I think he's definitely underrated as a guitarist.
Oh,
he's
my God, he's phenomenal.
He's an incredible musician.
He really
incredible.
Is. Interesting dude, too.
Very. Very much so. Absolutely.
Oh, man. How about a couple others? Santana. Oh, my God.
Similar situation. I was at the Jakarta Java Jazz Festival in Indonesia a few years ago.
Jakarta.
And I was performing out there with my group, and same situation. I knew a few guys, and they saw that I was on the lineup for the weekend, so they invited me to come up and play with him.
Wow.
So it was awesome.
Wow.
How fun. Who are the guys that are out there now that just blow you away musically? That, I mean, you just go. I mean, is there anybody that you just go, I will never ever attain that?
I would definitely say Stevie Wonder.
Yeah, well.
Stevie Wonder has been a huge influence on me personally, just his music, his songwriting, and everything that he's about. So he's the type of artist that I know I'll never be, but I absolutely love his music and what he does, and he's one of my favorites of all time.
Yeah, sure. It is really crazy to think of what everything he has done.
It's incredible.
That spurt of, you know, fulfilling his first finale and Songs in the Key of Life and all that. And what was the deal after he won Grammys like 2 or 3 years in a row and then Paul Simon wins and thanks Stevie Wonder. Thanks Stevie Wonder for not putting out an album that year. That was his acceptance speech.
Yeah, that was pretty
unbelievable. Unbelievable stuff. Have you met him?
I haven't. I've spoken
we'll
with
have
him.
To hook
Let's bring him out, ladies and gentlemen.
Wow. I've actually spoken with him a few times on
have
the
you?
Phone, but I haven't actually met
really?
Him in person.
Yeah.
How did that come about?
Okay, do tell.
Just friends, knowing people.
The wrong number.
No.
It was the wrong number right now. Hello, Stevie there.
How did you get him on? Did you call him? He called you?
Well, a good friend of mine is like great friends with him, and okay. she called him up and said, I want to introduce you to this young saxophone player. You have to speak
so
with him.
She put you on conference?
She put me on the phone with him.
Okay.
So I
wow.
had a brief conversation with him. He was really, really
what'd
nice.
You say?
I don't even remember. I was just like, oh, I can't believe I was speaking.
Hi.
I honestly don't remember. I was just in shock. But he was just really cool. I mean, he was very encouraging.
Aww.
He said, you know, just keep
come
on
play with
hard.
Me tonight.
I'm waiting for that call.
Yeah, there you go. There you go.
I'm waiting for that call.
What a life. What a life he's had.
Yeah, incredible.
Yeah, it is. Well, somebody started young as you did.
He did.
You know?
So I don't want to ask how old you are now, but you.
But how old are you now?
You're not in your 20s, right?
No, I'm no longer in my 20s.
Oh, well, you're done then.
Oh, no.
You're done.
Do
stick
you
a
remember,
fork in you.
Do you remember the first song that you wrote?
I do.
You do?
I do.
What age was that?
I was 13.
Okay, so
I'm going to play that for you guys tonight.
You are?
I am.
Really?
Absolutely.
Okay, so you're going to play your first song. So that, what inspired you to write that song at 13?
Well, I was getting ready for high school, and it was going to be a big change for me because I went to a small private school. There was literally 5 kids in my class.
Really?
Literally. Very small private school.
There were more kids than that in my detention.
I'm sure.
Oh, I really? Sure. God, I'm hating you.
That's too funny. So I was getting ready to go into high school, and I was just so excited just about the new experiences, about meeting a lot mm-hmm. of new people. And one thing that I was really, really looking forward to was getting my driver's license.
Ooh, at 13?
At 13. I was so tired of my parents taking me everywhere.
How can you get a driver's license at 13?
I didn't get it at 13.
Oh. Surprised you didn't have a driver.
Well, my dad kind of was my driver.
Yeah, right, exactly, exactly.
But it is still 16 in Florida, right?
It is.
Okay, good.
It is. So I was just kind of thinking about all the exciting things that were coming up, school, okay. getting my driver's license, and I always dreamed about having a Lamborghini. That's like my dream car. And I kind of pictured myself in high school.
Driving a Lamborghini.
Driving down. I think big.
Yeah, you do, yeah, okay.
Might as well,
We think big all the time.
See,
yeah, we
exactly.
do.
Exactly. So I just kind of pictured myself driving down the street, going to the beach with the top down, you know, the ladies kind of waving. While
See, I knew they were in there somewhere in that dream. I knew it.
At some point.
And so that's
and
the song?
That
okay.
that kind of inspired me to write a song.
Wow.
Know? And that's when I wrote my first real song.
Nice.
How fun. Talk about the process that you go through to write. I mean, how do you do it? Is there a particular way? Do you... You
know, drives his Lamborghini down the
street. Yeah, right. That's, exactly. Exactly.
Well, my process is different. I mean, everybody writes music differently.
Yeah.
Everybody has a different approach. But for me, when it comes to writing music, it stems from my experiences, the things that I go through, the things that influence me. And I pour all of those emotions into my music. So I can't really sit down, you know, and say, okay, today I'm
going
to write
a
song.
I'm going to write a song today.
I'm going to create a song. It doesn't work.
So you wake up
at
3 o'clock in the morning with these bing.
Literally. I mean, about a week ago, I woke up at 4 o'clock in the morning. I had this great idea. So I had to get out of my bed and then just kind of record a little idea. But songs just kind of come to me at sporadic moments. But it's really based off of experiences, things that I'm excited about or thinking about or emotions. And I just pour all of those emotions into my music. So I can be driving down the street. I can be taking a shower. Mm. I can be walking down the street. And then all of a sudden, a song comes to me. As a matter of fact, I think I have a song in my mind.
I was just going to say, you're sitting here with...
It's about Kelly's new haircut.
It's about
right.
the hair.
Exactly.
It's all about the hair.
Yeah it is.
Thank you.
That's a good song title.
Oh my gosh!
All about that.
We
hair.
Should collaborate.
We should. We can get your daughter to sing.
Oh yeah! Okay.
So that's how it works for me.
I can't fathom the people that are disciplined enough or whatever it is
mm-hmm.
to sit down and just go, now I'm going to write a song, and they do it.
Yeah. I wish I could.
Sometimes you
do
have
that.
To, though, if there's a record label that wants you to produce, it's
right.
like. It's like writing a book. We need it by X amount of dates.
Right.
Have you attempted to do that?
I have, but it didn't work for me.
It didn't.
I mean, I came up with this song idea and I didn't really like it, so I just kind of tossed it out. And I realized that it has to come naturally for me. I can't force creativity.
Yeah.
And that's what I realized, that it just has to be a natural process. Hair. It's all about the hair.
At last.
Finally, something he can't do.
talk about your first recording, okay? Your very, very first recording. You're now on a, you have a CD.
Right.
And you are now driving your Lamborghini down the road.
I am. Not quite. It was a Mazda Protege.
Oh, okay. But,
you know. That's...
Okay. Well...
But it's got a really good hood ornament.
It's
so, yeah, exactly.
It had a good sound system.
Yeah, right, exactly.
Where were you when you first heard your music on the radio?
I was in my car. I think I was driving to a gig. I had a show that night. And the radio station Tampa, Florida, 94.1, they were strong supporters of my music. I've been working with them literally since I was 13, 14 years old. Mm-hmm. So my dad gave them my CD, and then they started playing my music. And just one day, I was just driving down the street, you know, I had the radio on blast. I love to blast my music.
Absolutely.
And they said, next up, Eric Darius. I'm like, oh my gosh,
who's
really?
Who's that?
And then they played my song, and I was just in seventh heaven. It was just an amazing
What did
experience.
You do? I mean, did you stop? Did you, you know?
I kind of pulled over to the side of the road and just kind of listened for a minute. Then I called my mom, I called my dad, I called everybody, said, I'm on the radio.
So I was just going to say, does that really happen?
It does. It really does. It really does. It was a great experience.
Wow. Fun.
And it's still like that today. Every time I hear my song on the radio, it's like a really cool experience.
Nice.
Yeah.
Nice. You, this is the latest.
Ooh.
On a mission.
On a mission.
It's getting a little old.
Yeah, it's been around for a few years.
Yeah, a couple years. I mean, you've done four CDs.
Mm-hmm.
You are working on a new one right now, are you
I
not?
I am. And I'm sorry for the delay in this next project, but I've been on the road nonstop, performing for you.
Yeah. That's fine.
There you go.
That's all right.
It's definitely
that
time.
We don't want to rush the genius.
It's definitely that time. So I'm actually in the studio now. Well, not literally right now.
Yeah.
But working on a new project. I'm hoping to have it out probably by late summer.
Nice.
How does that process work for you? I mean, are you one of those guys that goes in there and you've got it already figured out in your head, or do you experiment?
It's a little bit of both. A lot of it is experimentation. I mean, for me, when it comes to an album, I approach it as a blank canvas. And I kind of think about different ideas or what kind of sound or direction I want to go in, but it just kind of naturally evolves as I start working on it. So literally, I'll go into the studio with a few producers without a song, and then we'll just kind of experiment with different sounds and styles and just kind of create something.
Who are you working with on this?
I can't tell you.
Oh.
It's a surprise.
So, really?
Okay. So my question then is, if you were to collaborate with anybody on this one, who would you pull in if you wanted to?
That's a really slick way of
trying to... As a reporter back in the day.
Exactly.
If you wanted to collaborate with anybody, who would you?
Besides, of course, Kelly on the It's All About the Hair song.
Well, yeah, of
exactly.
course.
Right.
Other than that song, I mean, if I could work with anybody, I'd love to collaborate with like a John Legend, Alicia Keys. I love her music.
Oh my goodness, yeah.
I mean, I can name tons of artists, but those are some of my favorites.
Any singers? You want any songs, like vocals?
Yeah, there's definitely going to be some vocals on this project.
Do you sing?
I do.
You do?
And you might find out on this next project.
Really?
Yeah. Oh, you guys. Yeah. Oh, that'll be fun.
Yeah, I'm excited. I've actually always been able to sing.
Uh-huh.
And I actually sang on my first album, on Night on the Town. There's a song called You're So Fine.
Oh,
and
that's right.
I sing on that track. But that was the first recording I actually sang. So I'm definitely looking to bring that out a little more.
Well, there are so many, I mean, the sax is, well-stated or often stated as the closest to the voice.
Right.
So, I mean, there are so many similarities.
Absolutely.
Yeah. How interesting.
Ought to be a very interesting year.
Yeah, it's going to be. I'm very excited. 2013 is going to be great. So I'm excited about what's to come.
Well, it's starting off great. And
I couldn't think of a better way to start.
Eric Darius, you got to love it. We are, this is going too fast, man.
I know.
We're going to take a break and come back, and Eric is going to play for us again. So please stick around here on Breakfast with Gary and Kelly.
Sandy.
I like All About the Hair.
You like that? Wow. Hey, guys.
Welcome back to Breakfast with Gary and Kelly, everybody. Are you having fun this morning?
Yeah.
Is this, wow. Is this not a talented kid or what? You know, I'm telling you.
So good.
What are you gonna do? We got another tune. We got another tune, right?
I'm gonna play one more song.
All right.
Okay.
All right.
And this is actually the first song I ever wrote.
This is that one that you wrote when you were 13.
All right. Eric Darius, everybody.
All right. Thank you.
The one you want right now. Till the new one comes out. Eric, thank you so much, man.
Too fun.
Thank you. That's Eric Darius, everybody. Thanks for being here. We appreciate it. Hope you had fun. We'll catch you next time. Breakfast with Gary and Kelly.
Thank you for coming.
So it was by request that they wanted me to do the Alicia Keys song, If I Ain't Got You. So this is If I Ain't Got You.
One more time, Eric Darius! Woo!